Okay, the final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 6325 in the name of Evelyn Tweed on Ferrier family raises £30,280.90 for Cardiomyopathy UK. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons or place an RTS in the chat function if they're joining us online. And I invite Ms Tweed to open the debate for around about 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Callum Ferrier was a tall, happy young man. He played shinty and had just taken up rugby. With hopes of becoming a motor mechanic, he had his whole life ahead of him. In 2013, 16-year-old Callum went to bed with a sore head. He was found the next day by his father, having died in the night. His tragic and untimely death devastated his mother, his father, and his three brothers. Callum had cardiomyopathy, a condition affecting the shape of his heart. The Ferrier family from Doon and Deanston in my constituency have gone on to fundraise over £30,000 for Cardiomyopathy UK, the national charity for those with this disease. Through Kayleigh's treks all over the world, skydives and concerts, Callum's family are honouring his legacy and raising awareness. This charity is working to extend their offering in Scotland, but they need volunteers to develop peer groups and provide advocacy. Cardiomyopathy is a group of conditions, and various forms affect the heart in different ways. Dilated cardiomyopathy leads the walls of the heart to become stretched and thin, while hypertrophic cardiomyopathy sees muscle cells in the heart enlarging, thickening the heart walls. With arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy, cells in the heart muscle don't stick together properly, so the heart wall can become weak. These conditions have a range of causes, but in many cases, they are genetic. They can all reduce the heart's ability to pump blood around the body and can lead to heart failure. At least one in 250 people in the UK have cardiomyopathy, but for many it remains undiagnosed. Young, active and a keen rugby player, Callum's story is sadly not unique, and according to the British Heart Foundation, at least 12 people under 35 in the UK die from an undiagnosed heart condition every week. And you will probably be like me in thinking this is quite a high statistic, this is quite a high number and something that we need to be concerned about. With diagnosis and treatment, these tragic deaths can be prevented. But Dr. Stephen Cox, Chief Executive of Cardiac Risk in the Young, or CRY, says that there are no signs or symptoms in 80% of cases of cardiomyopathy. Because for many, the first indication of the condition is death. Awareness and access to screening programmes are vital. Just weeks before Callum's death, Phil O'Donnell died on the pitch, the captain of Motherwell Football Club. Mr. O'Donnell also had cardiomyopathy. High-profile deaths like this one led to a rise in screening programmes, first for young athletes, but now available for many young people through charities such as CRY. Their activities are funded mainly through the efforts of those who have lost relatives. CRY screens around 27,000 young people every year for free. Free screenings, however, book up quickly, with well over 1 million people in Scotland aged 14 to 35. A more sustainable and far-reaching strategy for screening is required. Although frequently undetected, it is possible to diagnose cardiomyopathy. Doctors use scans and tests such as electrocardiograms, echocardiograms and MRIs. And once diagnosed, the condition can be managed through lifestyle, medication or surgery. Diagnosis for family members is also available on the NHS due to the genetic nature of the condition. Symptoms can go unnoticed or remain mild or can get worse over time. They include breathlessness, chest pain, the feeling faint or lightheaded, the abdomen, legs or feet may become swollen. The rhythm of the heart may be abnormal. However, Cardiomyopathy UK found that 73% of patients with symptoms did not associate their symptoms with a heart problem at the time of diagnosis. And the charity also highlights that those with symptoms spend a long time in primary care before diagnosis, which suggests we need more awareness amongst healthcare professionals. I tried searching the common symptoms online, and when typing swollen legs in on NHS Inform, heart failure only comes up on page 3. And it only mentions cardiomyopathy in passing. It's not listed under chest pains. It's not mentioned under breathlessness. There is plenty of information on cardiomyopathy out there, but only for those who know to look for it. A page on NHS Inform to highlight the condition to parents and young people who may be Googling symptoms would go some way to bridge the gap. The Scottish Government's Heart Disease Action Plan from 2021 sets out that heart disease is a priority. However, cardiomyopathy is only mentioned in passing, and a more robust outline of the plan relating to this condition would be welcomed by many. I look forward to hearing how the Government will ensure that raising awareness of cardiomyopathy, as well as providing pathways for screening, is built into this strategy. Morag, Callum's mum, said, "If, as a family, we do nothing else, we are raising awareness of this silent killer." They hope that their work prevents other families from going through the heartache that they still feel with Callum's untimely death. I am grateful, and I know the Ferrier family are too, for the interest and engagement on this debate, and I look forward to a future where cardiomyopathy is diagnosed and treated for as many young people as possible. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Stewart. We now move to the open debate. I call first Alexander Stewart, to be followed by Christine Graham. Around 4 minutes, Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful for the opportunity to contribute and congratulate Evelyn Tweed on bringing her members' business debate to the Chamber this evening. I would also like to convey my most sincere condolences to the Ferrier family on their deeply tragic loss of Callum. Although I acknowledge this awful event happened almost exactly 15 years ago, I know from personal experience that no amount of years can cushion the type of loss in such terrible and unexpected circumstances. Deputy Presiding Officer, many colleagues will know that in the last parliamentary session, I was pleased to have been a co-convener of the previous cross-party group on heart disease and stroke. Collectively, during that time, fellow MSPs, together with patients, health professionals, consultants and the British Heart Foundation as the Secretariat, along with the Stroke Association and other charities involved, achieved a great deal of many objectives in the research and treatment of a myriad of heart conditions and sadly affect many people across Scotland and the wider UK. When I was invited to do similar for the new cross-party group on heart and disease, this opportunity and this parliamentary session, I was delighted to take up that opportunity. As we have already heard, the motivation and the motions explains about the cardiomyopathy is a disease of the heart muscle, which is manifested in many forms. It ensures, however, that it makes it harder for the organ to pump blood to the rest of the body, and which can tragically lead to heart failure. Often in the case of young Callum was one of many who have suffered from this condition. And there are no real symptoms at all, and individuals can feel completely well before the situation occurs with tragic circumstances. Indeed, the scenario renders the effects of subsequent heart failure as a result even more devastating. And this Deputy Presiding Officer makes the Ferrier's fundraising achievements even more substantial and extraordinary. To raise excess of £30,000 is a phenomenal achievement. The way that they have dealt with such a terrible loss affecting grief and no doubtly dark times, but have turned that round through time into a superhuman example of courage, determination and the wish to help others is truly exceptional. The target of such demonstration and focus to hear about what's happening with Cardiomyopathy UK, that the charity, the only UK charity dedicated to providing support and information to everyone affected by this condition. The charity realises externally and donations are what it relies on to ensure that it can and does have a prompt a working to try and prevent a diagnosis and get information treatment to save lives and improve the quality of people affected by the condition. And it's all about trying to ensure that the message is put across. And a debate of this nature this evening is an example of what we can all do to try and highlight the circumstances and situations. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, I wholeheartedly commend what the Ferriers have done and Cardiomyopathy UK for all it has done, but also congratulate the local businesses, the clubs, the organisations, the schools involved in all of this that's mentioned in the motion for their tireless and unceasing endeavours to benefit all levels of research, treatment and well-being for everyone affected by this devastating and often silent condition. And as has been said already this evening, raising awareness is what we need to do. We are very privileged to have that opportunity to ensure that we can raise awareness and we can fight the corner for many individuals who do not have that opportunity. And we take that very much on board. And I thank you for the opportunity of contributing to this member's debate. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Claire Baker. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak in the debate in support of my colleague and all who've campaigned over the years to highlight the issue of cardiomyopathy and indeed the need for defibrillators. And I also comment that you yourself, Deputy Presiding Officer, have taken part in previous debates. This will be my fifth debate on this issue, the first in 2001, then 2010, 2014 and 2021. I want to put on record my condolences to Mr. and Mrs. Ferrier, even while I congratulate their funding efforts following their own tragic circumstances. Similarly, I first became engaged with cardiomyopathy when I met Kenneth and Wilma Gunn, then constituents of mine in Selkirk, who established Scottish Heart, the Borders-based charity which is also known as the Cameron Gunn Memorial Fund, set up after their son died from hypertrophic cardiomyopathy many years ago. Since then, Mr. and Mrs. Gunn, over these decades, have worked tirelessly to promote awareness of cardiomyopathy and to encourage the testing of young athletes. Back then, they were endeavouring to raise £0.25 million that was required to provide a mobile echocardiogram that could be used at sports clubs and schools to test young people. This is a disease usually more recognisable to people under the headlines that we unfortunately sometimes read, such as sudden death on sports field, heart condition kills youth, or teenager in mystery death. Cameron Gunn was playing five-a-side football with workmates, practising for a charity game when he suddenly dropped down dead. He was 19 and it was his 20th birthday the next day. Young people are still dying in similar circumstances. So I pay tribute to other members of the Parliament who raised awareness of cardiomyopathy and, of course, the work of Scottish Heart, which stands for Heart at Risk Testing. Ewan Robson, former Liberal Democrat MSP, first lodged a motion on the issue in 1999, followed by former Labour MSP Joanne Lamont in 2001, myself in 2003, and again former SSP MSP Rosemary Byrne in 2004. It covers huge cross-party support. I recognise the campaigning by outside organisations that are involved in cardiomyopathy prevention, and it has made progress, and all parties have responded to it. Malcolm Chisholm, who was then the Health Minister, met Wilma and Kenny Gunn, and then Nicola Sturgeon. Both gave up a lot of time to discuss the issues with them. That shows that with a heartfelt commitment to an issue that requires attention, ordinary people, such as the Ferriers and the Gunns, can with determination change things in Parliament, and it shows that politicians do listen, and there are results. Following a petition to Parliament and further meeting with representations from Kenny and Will McGann and Scottish Heart, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing launched a pilot screening programme in conjunction with health professionals and the SFA at Hampden Park. It involves screening amateur athletes aged 16 or over for life-threatening conditions. The Cabinet Secretary at that time put in a further £150,000 of funding to extend the screening pilot over the coming years. It actually then found 400 youngsters who exhibited risk factors that ranged from mild to serious. Even if one life saved is excellent, so the programme was invaluable. The Guns campaign for defibrillators in public areas such as large supermarkets, airports, train and bus stations, and that's what's happened over the years. There has been movement. Fast forward to 2021, and I quote from my contribution then. From 1997 onwards, Wilma and her husband Kenny have been fundraising, raising the organisation's profile in Parliament and campaigning not only for early testing of young athletes, but for accessible defibrillators. Back then, not many people knew what a defibrillator was, including myself in that. Their profile was raised here in debates and petitions to the Parliament, and in 2014, Wilma was deservedly awarded an MBE. Today, as I said, we have defibrillators at many points, trains, stations, bus stations, airports and supermarkets, and in Parliament and some workplaces. But Kenny and Wilma have not stopped campaigning, and they're keen for even more to be distributed. The new ones are easy to use. You can't hurt the patient by using them. In fact, it's better to use a defibrillator than have the patient die in front of you for lack of action, as you cannot do any more harm than if you'd done nothing. I have practiced in defibrillators in the Parliament elsewhere, and if I can use them, because I'm hopeless with anything practical, anyone else certainly can. Those invaluable minutes on the defibrillator will mean life or death until the medics arrive. That is especially relevant in rural areas such as my constituency, where paramedics cannot simply arrive within 8 minutes. Close quotes. Now, I wanted to take part in this debate to remind members of others, just like the Ferriers, through their own tragic circumstances, who tried to move this debate forward, to try to bring defibrillators, testing where necessary to save so many young lives to the forefront. And I congratulate the Ferriers, as I remain forever congratulating Wilma and Kenny Gunn, who all these years later, and I say as the Ferriers, keep campaigning. It does produce results.
Thank you, Ms Graham. I now call Claire Baker, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Fulton McGregor. Ms Baker, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to thank Evelyn Tweed for bringing this debate to the Chamber and join with others in paying tribute to Callum Ferrier, who sadly lost his life to hypertrophic cardiomyopathy in 2008. The grief experienced by a family for the loss of a loved one is significant, and for the Ferrier family, the loss of Callum must have been devastating. To experience the death of a healthy, fit young person with their life ahead of them is a tragedy. And so it's testament to the Ferrier family they have invested time, effort and resources into fundraising for Cardiomyopathy UK. And it's fitting that their dedication is recognised in a parliamentary debate. Their fundraising efforts and their continuing work in raising awareness of cardiomyopathy and supporting Cardiomyopathy UK should be praised. The breadth of campaigning and fundraising highlighted by Evelyn Tweed is impressive, and their ability to galvanise others is evident. I hope that by having this debate today, we are able to contribute to increasing awareness of these conditions, the importance of testing and the treatment and support which is available. As the motion for the debate stresses, cardiomyopathy is not a single condition, rather a group of conditions which affect the structure of the heart and reduce its ability to pump blood. Some people may get cardiomyopathy as a result of another condition or risk factor that they have, and for others it's a genetic condition that can be passed down, but for many the cause is not able to be found. The NHS estimate the condition to affect 1 in 500 people. And that figure is reflected by the number of us who know a family who has experienced this tragic loss. I know how devastating it is for a family to lose a young son or daughter in these circumstances. Sudden death of a young person is a huge shock for everyone, as the condition often goes undiagnosed, and the young person can often be someone who's athletic and active in sports. At least 1,600 people across the UK are living with cardiomyopathy. Some people may be aware of it as a result of symptoms such as feeling tired, dizzy or lightheaded, breathlessness or chest pains, swelling in their legs or stomach, but others will have no symptoms at all. Most of the people who live in the UK with cardiomyopathy are undiagnosed. When Phil O'Donnell died following his football match in 2007, as Evelyn Tweed mentioned, it was the first time many of us had heard about cardiomyopathy and how it can cause cardiac arrest without warning. Only a few weeks later, Callum Ferrier lost his life to the same condition. While there is no cure for cardiomyopathy, there are effective treatment options and most symptoms can be controlled through medication, devices like pacemakers or surgery. This is why raising awareness of cardiomyopathy is so important. If people are aware of the symptoms, if they know of any family disease of history of heart disease or sudden unexplained death, they can talk to their GP about their own risk and if required, take steps to manage it. With the right treatment and support, people with cardiomyopathy can lead healthy and full lives. Increased testing for cardiomyopathy would help allow people with risk factors to be assessed and if found to have a condition, to take steps to manage it. In 2017, the British Heart Foundation launched a UK-wide genetic testing service, which allowed an additional 800 people a year to be screened for hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, with test centres across the UK, including at the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital in Glasgow. And the Cure Heart Research Project, which Cardiomyopathy UK is a part of, recently won the international competition, the Big Beat Challenge, securing a £300 million research grant. It was recognised as the project with the most chance of delivering a revolutionary advance in cardiovascular health and disease. The Cure Heart team aimed to develop a treatment which targets and silences the faulty gene responsible for cardiomyopathies. So, Presiding Officer, I will close on that positive news. While the Ferrier family have experienced great loss, their actions and dedication to improving outcomes for future generations is a message of hope and one which I applaud and very much welcome this afternoon.
Thank you very much, Ms. Baker. And I call Fulton McGregor again for around 4 minutes, Mr. McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I hadn't actually intended to speak until I heard Evelyn Tweed's opening speech today and how powerful that it was and reminded me of a situation in my own constituency. So I might not take up the whole 4 minutes, but I do appreciate you allowing me to speak in this debate. And I want to just say again, as I said there, Evelyn Tweed's very powerful opening speech and I think a great tribute to the Ferrier family and to Callum, and it must have been very difficult to go up and speak in the way that she did, but I think she has done the family proud and put on record the work that they are doing to continue to fundraise, and also as well as Claire Baker raising Phil O'Donnell as well, who of course was a Motherwell player. What it brought to mind with me is an issue I've raised, Presiding Officer, in this Parliament before through motions and in the Chamber, and that's relating to the very similar story of young Kieran McDade, who died on the 26th of August 2016, not long actually after the election of that year, while training with Dunbeth Football Club in Coatbridge, just 13 years old. And I felt that after Evelyn Tweed's speech that I should also make mention of him again and pay dedication to him and his legacy since. As I said, he was only 13 years old and he was known as being dedicated to his team, Dunbeth Football Club, a well-known team in the Coatbridge area. They had actually won the youth championship and they were training at the time when he very sadly passed away. A massive Celtic fan, and I think that one of the players in the Celtic game that followed actually paid tribute to him when the player scored a goal against, I think it was Lee Griffiths, and he scored a goal against Aberdeen, and he removed his top to pay tribute to young Kieran, and that would have been a very poignant moment for his family. But following from that, the whole instance actually it transpired in the club, the football club, helping to found the Kieran McDade Foundation, which launched in 2017, a year later, and now which runs a tournament annually, very well attended with teams from all across central Scotland. And the purpose of this foundation is to raise money for defibrillators, which they have now given out. The last update I had was about 115, but I'm sure it will be more now because that doesn't include the most recent tournament, and they give out to grassroots football teams, particularly across Scotland, but also in England and in Ireland, and defibrillators to local organisations. And one of such, which I also laid a motion for, was one of these said defibrillators was at is placed at the West End Bar in Airdrie, and actually very recently helped to save an individual's life. So a very, very big legacy this young person is continuing to leave. I know that the team, Dunbeth, regularly post about him and obviously post a lot about the Kieran McDaid Foundation, and are keen that defibrillators are in every town and village across Scotland. And I know that's something that's got a lot of cross-party support in the Parliament, and that continued that this young boy, just like Callum's legacy, is continued, and that we get to a place where routine screening for young people, particularly those who are active, becomes a reality. And hopefully these sort of things of the past, but that these individuals' legacies go on to do good. And thanks for letting me speak, Presiding Officer, and thanks again to Evelyn Tweed for inspiring the debate. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McGregor. I now call Kevin Stewart to respond to the debate. Minister, for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to open my speech today by offering my condolences to the Ferriers on the devastating loss of Callum. As we've already heard, sadly, Callum died in his sleep, aged 16, as a result of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. From the accounts I've seen, Callum was a young man who loved sports, a rugby player and a football fan. He supported Rangers and local side Doune Castle. And Evelyn Tweed's debate today has been an opportunity for members from across the chamber to recognise his life and the ongoing impact of his loss. It also raises the importance of quality care and support for people with cardiomyopathy and the issue of out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, both of which I will touch upon in my speech. But first of all, it's important for us to recognise that in the 15 years since Callum's death, his family have carried out exceptional fundraising efforts in his memory. They have raised over £30,000 for charity, and this has been achieved by carrying out a number of quite incredible challenges. To mention just a few, they have climbed Machu Picchu, trekked the Sahara and the Great Wall of China, gone skydiving and ran multiple marathons. The result of these efforts has gone on to provide support for Cardiomyopathy UK, which is the specialist national charity for people affected by cardiomyopathy. The charity provides support and information, campaigns for better access to quality treatment, saves lives through raising awareness, and provides hope through shaping research. Third sector partners, including Cardiomyopathy UK, play an important role in driving improvement for people with cardiac conditions in Scotland. The Scottish Government is grateful for their continued work and engagement in this area. Cardiomyopathy UK have outlined the importance of early detection and diagnosis, improving specialist treatment, access to genetic and family testing, and ongoing care and support. At this point, I should explain that cardiomyopathy refers to a group of conditions which affect the structure of the heart and impact its ability to pump blood around the body. There can be a number of different causes for this, but in many cases, it is a genetic condition that can be passed down through families. This might also be referred to as an inherited cardiac condition. There is a network for inherited cardiac conditions in Scotland, known as NICs. This is a national managed clinical network which supports improvements in the detection, diagnosis, treatment and outcomes of people with inherited cardiac conditions, including but not limited to inherited cardiomyopathies. NICs brings together healthcare professionals, people affected by inherited cardiac conditions and relevant third sector organisations. And together, they are supporting the delivery of quality patient care across our country. There are a number of helpful patient resources and healthcare professional guidance available on the NICS website for anyone who might be interested in learning more about their work. And I'd like to use this opportunity to recognise and give my thanks to everyone involved in NICS. Before closing, I'll touch upon some of the wider work of the Scottish Government which has relevance to this debate. We recognise the scale and impact of heart diseases in Scotland and continue to deliver our Heart Disease Action Plan. The priorities and actions within that align closely with much of what Cardiomyopathy UK have identified as important areas for improvement. That is, the action plan has a focus on early detection and diagnosis, improving specialist treatment and ensuring access to ongoing care and support for people living with a cardiac condition. Further to this, reflecting on the loss of Callum is a difficult reminder that each year in Scotland, over 3,000 people experience a cardiac arrest in the community. Also, I'll certainly give way to Ms. Graham.
Christine Graham.
I tended to focus on defibrillators, and we've come a long way. But I just wonder, do we know where they are located? For example, do we know local authority areas? Could they map where there are defibrillators? So if somebody's in an emergency, they know where to get one.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I know that in some areas the defibrillators are mapped, but I will get back to Ms Graham and see if we have a national mapping system in place. I don't have that information to hand, but that's certainly that I'll get back. Certainly something I'll get back to Ms Graham on. We're working in partnership with Save a Life for Scotland to deliver the out-of-hospital cardiac arrest strategy. This includes a focus on ensuring that in instances where a cardiac arrest is witnessed, people have the skills and confidence to intervene. The overall aim is to increase CPR and defibrillation rates, leading to increased survival. So it's also important to highlight that beyond this, the strategy recognises the significant impact of witnessing a cardiac arrest or sudden cardiac death. And that's why the Scottish Government have recently provided funding to Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland and the Research Resuscitation Group of Edinburgh University to deliver a pilot project of aftercare support for people who have had this experience. In summary, Presiding Officer, I'm very grateful for the opportunity to speak on this motion tonight. It has reminded the Chamber of the importance of efforts to improve early detection, diagnosis and access to care for people with cardiac conditions across Scotland. It has also served as a reminder of the importance of ongoing work to increase survival from out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, and of providing aftercare to support those folks that have been impacted. I'd like to reiterate my thanks to Cardiomyopathy UK for their vital work in supporting people with these conditions across these islands, and also to NICS, who play such an important role in ensuring that people affected by cardiomyopathy in Scotland have access to quality care. Finally, to close this debate, I'd like to put on record remembrance of Callum Ferrier and give my sincere congratulations to his family for all that they have achieved in his memory. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate and I close this meeting of Parliament.